Good afternoon. Thank you all for attending today's all call. Please take your seats and silence all cell phones and radios. We will begin shortly. Chief. That's why I'm like looking for her. It's like, where's she going? To the back? Team Test Wing, welcome to the 412 Test Wing All Call, hosted by Brigadier General Matthew Heiger and Chief Master Sergeant Denisha Ward Swanigan. Please rise for the entrance of the official party.
Room, page up.
Good afternoon, carry on. So for those of you that don't remember the pre-pandemic ROEs that I had, and you're seated in the back third of this auditorium, there's a bunch of empty seats up here. Come on down. Hey, Chief, stop right there. Stop. Take three steps back. Stop. Everybody behind the Chief, move forward. Hurry up. Chief has to stay and make sure it happens. Come on. What are you new? He is, by the way. He's a brand new Chief. Welcome to the world. Come on, plenty of seats, right here. This is kind of new for us, right? 3 years for me in the seat here shortly. The great news about what we've all gone through the last 3 years, two years, 9 months, is that right now those that can't be here are watching us. I hear there are watch parties, so shout out to everybody that's in a watch party. And also a shout out to those that are executing mission right now that can't make it and are watching this in a replay or a rebroadcast. So good on everybody there too. Come on, plenty of seats. Come on. 6,286 people waiting. All right. So while they're filling into the seats, and if you're here in person, this is not verboten today. And for those of you that are watching online, your phones are encouraged. That number on the screen, 707, as in the big airframe from Boeing, right? 707. 412-8922, and if you look at the telephone touchpad, that's TWCC. So think big airplane, early Boeing, 412 test wing commander. That number is always available for you to text in comments, questions, suggestions, or anything else you'd like to get to the 412 test wing top five. We use it in this time block on every duty day Friday at town halls, and in this case, an all call. So if you are not here in person, that's how you get a question or a comment or suggestion to me today. If I don't get to it today, we will get to it. The number is available 24/7, 365, so you don't have to hit us just when we're in session. If you're here in person and you'd like to type something but don't want to stand up and ask it, that's fine. But I look forward to your dialogue and your engagement here after I get through a couple charts. All right. Thanks for moving down. Still a couple stragglers. Where's my chief? Okay, come on. Go police the crowd. Come on, chief. Come on. All right. And I want to highlight that, Doc Waters, would you mind standing up for me? He has a beautiful colored shirt on. Thanks for bringing that to the base theater. Yeah, all right. Okay. Let's go to the next chart, please. Wait, I need the number. 707. 412-8922. You're welcome. All right. So for those of you online, sorry you can't participate in our quiz. It is graded, and those here get bonus points. So here's the quiz. It's multi-questioned, and I want to hear shout-outs from the audience. Ready? You game? Chief knows the answer, so she's not gonna answer. Right? Everybody ready? Okay, all right. So how many Air Force core values are there? And I'm looking for a number. It's between 3 and 3. Okay, 3. So everybody warmed up? Okay, next question. What are they? The first one is, one word.
Integrity.
Build, please.
Oh.
Yeah. So the beta test version would say integrity first, right? And then I'd say, what's the next one? And you would say?
Service.
Service, one word, right? Integrity, service, excellence. We've already shown you the answers. But service before self, okay? The third one word, would say excellence. You would shout excellence. But the full phrase is what? Excellence in?
All.
Yeah. So teammates, these are not hollow words, and those are not hollow phrases. And I don't care what uniform you wear. If you're a Big A Airman, you wear a uniform. Some of us wear a uniform that looks like civilian clothes, but you're members of my team as well. And we are all members of this Air Force. And these have been the core values literally as long as I can remember in the Air Force. And they're that long and they're that enduring because they're valuable, they're real, and they are exceptionally meaningful. So when you are wondering, like, gosh, should I exceed the speed limit on Rosamond Boulevard? Because it's the middle of the night, there's no one out here, and the chances of a defender being there. So I'm just going to do it. I hope that you will think to yourself these three words in Air Force core values. Integrity. This installation commander requires us all to drive the speed limit on base all the time, 24/7, 365. And I'm not sure I could care less what the state of California enforces outside the wire, not outside the gates, because the wall is the installation, right, Josh? Okay. Drive the speed limits. Two other things important as long as we're talking about cars. Stop means stop, not roll. Right? And hands-free actually means hands-free. Okay? So, what's the benefit of doing something when nobody can watch and you do it right? You get to live with yourself and sleep with yourself, and you get to model to the folks that you live with and work with that, yes, in fact, I actually do set my speed limit on Rosemont Boulevard at 65, and I actually have to do a lot of policing often when I drive in and out the gates. I need all of us to do better so I can do a little bit less of that, and we'll talk to that a little bit more. Is if you're in a hurry because you're late on that same vignette, is that putting yourself before your service? It might be. There are other vignettes and other examples there too. And I tell you what it ain't. It ain't excellence in all you do. And if somebody passes you going faster, take a note and let the defenders know. We can track down that person, talk to them, and talk to their chain of command and remind them that these three words and these three phrases actually mean something in our Air Force, and they're absolutely meaningful here at the center of the aerospace testing universe. The whys matter. And again, I'll pull this thread and I'll pull this vignette. Folks, for more than 2 years now, what have I said about the speed limits on Rosemont Boulevard? Chief's heard me say it a dozen times. I think 65 is too low. But it's the limit. And once I hear from the defenders that everybody's actually driving the posted speed limit, what can I literally do? Right here, what can I literally do? I can change the speed limit to let everybody drive 70. But everybody has to drive 65 first. Mr. Judkins is thinking to himself, boss, that ain't ever gonna happen. Right, Judd? Right? Maybe more words to that. So prove him and prove us all wrong and enforce that. And that's one example, one road, one example, but it permeates everything that we do every day, 24/7, 365. All right, next. What's the 412 Test Wing vision statement? A little bit more obscure, and if you got your phones, maybe you can Google it, but it's relatively simple. It's something that you heard my predecessor say a lot. What is it? Anybody want to shout? Want to guess? The center of the aerospace testing universe. Shout out to Brigadier General John Tyker, newly retired, for that. But you know what? So build. I can't say it repeatedly, so I shortened it because I'm a much simpler man than Dragon Tyker. And I just say Takotatu. You can spell it a few different ways, but it's Takotatu. It's a culture, right? Do we do everything at Edwards Air Force Base for aerospace for our entire nation? No. But I challenge you to come up with something that doesn't have its roots or its core in our aerospace industry, especially the last 60 to 70 years, that didn't happen within 100 miles of where we are all seated right now. Maybe it's people, maybe it's process, maybe it's doing the first thing for the first time. Now, we just celebrated the 75th anniversary of the breaking of the sound barrier, right, which happened in the skies above where we are right now. And truly what has emanated from this place, the center of this place, is excellence. And it was a whole bunch of people doing service before self. And overwhelmingly, they could not do that if they didn't hold fast to the core value of integrity as well. So, Takotatu means a lot. It is our vision statement. And it will be our vision statement for as long as that the 412 Test Wing Guidon is in my office. All right. And oh, by the way, if you'd like a nice t-shirt, they say Takotatu and they're in the gift shop at the BX. And no, AFES didn't pay me to say that, but they're there. Okay, next. All right, a little bit more there. I'm not going to ask you to shout it out, but I'm going to build it. Hopefully this builds as I beta tested it, so hit the build. So if you think about what our services mission statement is, and you look at the word in that mission statement that says air power, what do? For our services mission, we fuel it. We fuel it with innovation. We fuel it with going places that no one has gone before, literally. We fuel it with writing the tech orders to let people generate combat power. We fuel it with infusing airmen with excitement that have been here and been stationed here and then go back into the Air Force. We literally fuel it with testing aviation fuel. We also literally fuel it with the technology that is being developed and has been developed for more than 75 years here at Edwards and will for the foreseeable decades into the future. We literally fuel air power. Any way you define air power, the 412 test wing fuels it. So how do we fuel air power? We do world premier test and evaluation, right? A lot of people can generate data. And for those of you that are in that part of our mission set, you know what I'm talking about here. A lot of people generate data. Very few people have the expertise to take raw data and turn it into information that's usable to decision makers. That is evaluation, and that is one of our core tenets and one of our core principles, and that's a huge impact. But we don't just do it on anything. We test tomorrow's technology today. We train tomorrow's testers today. We teach, we train, we develop tomorrow's leaders here today. So that's our vision, and that's our mission statement. And I'm proud to share those with you. And I challenge you to fold those into what you talk around your dinner table and what you talk about to new folks in the unit and what you talk about with our mission partners and what you talk about across the broader test center enterprise, the larger Air Force and DoD enterprise, and our coalition partners as well. And I think you can find yourself in here and you can find the work that you and your people do in here in spades. And so I challenge you to do that and then communicate it. Next. So Chief and I have been talking a lot about what do we do now that I've dropped a combat front, so a precursor to another slide. What are we going to do in this opportunity that we have for the first time in almost 3 years? And that's it, right? In the first calendar quarter of 2023, which is crazy for me to say, I want to focus us or refocus us on the third Air Force core value, which is excellence in all we do. It's not retroactive, it's not punitive, it's a refocus. And I'll give you some examples, but I've already given you one, and what is it? What's the example that I've already given? Driving the speed limit. And demanding that of the folks that work with you and for you, and you work for. Okay, so that is but one. It's not a trivial example, but it is one example that I think impacts thousands of people in this space every day. All right, so next build, please. Here's the quote that I need you to promulgate. And I literally mean it, but I also want you to figuratively take it. So I want you to literally pull weeds and pick up litter where you see it in and around your work center, in and around the BX parking lot. For those of you that live on base, maybe even in and around your quarters on base, as I do, right? But I don't just mean that literally, and you may quote me on that, please, but I also mean it figuratively, too. So, Chief, if I were to ask you for an example of what is an example that you and I may have experienced just outside this theater when we did our last COVID tests of pulling weeds and picking up litter?
A young airman who didn't salute a one-star general standing this close for about 2 to 3 minutes.
Yeah, and I finally had to ask the airman if his arm was broken. Who was with that airman? Other airmen. What do you think about that? Is that excellence? Who should have corrected that airman? His wingman. Right? Okay. I'm not going to name what squadron. Chief and I have the name of the person, but it got handled on the spot. All of you have the abilities and the opportunities to do that. And it doesn't matter because I want us to be perfect. It matters because excellence matters. Excellence is how we save resources. Excellence is how we save lives. Excellence is how we make our nation's spear sharper. In fact, the tip of the spear sharper. That is what excellence does for us. And we can't be excellent if we don't have integrity and we don't place service to our larger cause before ourselves. And there are occasionally times where I need you to be selfish, but overall, we all need to contribute more than we demand on the system, especially over the duration of our enlistment or the duration of our time in service, or if you're fortunate enough to serve it a couple decades like Chief and I have over the course of your career. Okay? If you want to write down that quote, if you want to take a picture of it, if you want to snap it in the YouTube video, please be leaders that you are and help me help everyone pull little weeds before they become big and pick up litter before it blows on the flat line and fods out a motor. And then you can take that example and you can promulgate it to the folks that you work with and that you work for and that work for you. Contractors, maybe there are kids in your neighborhood, right? I'll give you an example of what excellence isn't. Excellence is not shoplifting. That's a real example too, okay? I need us to refocus on that. We have until 31 March to refocus on that, and then we need to move out in quarter number two and take advantage of this lull in the pandemic, which I hope stays that way, but history teaches recently that it won't. And that's why it's so important that we refocus on it for this quarter. All right, next. Okay, for those of you that have heard me talk before on our combat fronts, the previous AFMC commander used to foot stomp, and I couldn't agree more, and General Richardson agrees as well. AFMC units overwhelmingly perform their wartime mission in garrison every day. And there are very, very, very few exceptions to that, right? And so what is our wartime mission? What are the combat fronts that we continue to fight in, right? Well, you see the top one is no longer bolded. I assess, it's not a belief, I assess that we have now established that virus in an endemic manner, much like the flu virus, much like RSV, much like other things. It's going to be a real factor, but it is now endemic. Some of you still have something on your face, which tells me that you are fighting or something close, and I expect all of us to protect risk to force and risk to mission. You're going to see me with one more good week of data. Cross your fingers, everybody. I'll be able to move the installation back to HBCon Alpha, and I really look forward to the day that the numbers in our local area allow us to go to HBCon Normal, HBCon Zero. And I'll adjust that as required, but we're in and executing as if COVID is now endemic. Make sense? Okay. The other three combat fronts are enduring, and they're still with us today. So the next one is we need to prepare today to fight tonight. If you're a defender, if you're an LRS troop, if you are a command post controller, if you're a 3F5, if you're some of the maintainers that are active duty, your preparation today also might include a deployment today to fight tonight in an AOR. But all of us are preparing today to fight tonight. And the fight tonight is the protection of the installation. Yes, on the front line there are Josh Frizzell and our mighty 412th Security Forces Squadron defenders, both here and at Plant 42. But they need all of us all the time, 24/7, 365. Right? If you see something, say something. It's real. And it takes all of us to do that. And we have to prepare today to fight tonight. Could they do it during the day? Sure. But generally, it's going to be some type of a night event or night penetration, and I need you to focus on that. If you see something odd or weird in your building, around your car, around your house, anywhere, take some data, keep yourself at a safe distance, call the defenders, or at least get some information and pass it on. Okay? So that's the prepare today to fight tonight. Nothing new there. All of us that have been in service have done that for a big part of our decade, big part of our decades in service. The next one is, we are quite literally in this environment, like literally in this town hall, we are actually fighting in the cyber domain against adversaries literally right now. North Korea would love to give us a denial of service at big events like this. And those that are online can text in and go, we're beating the DPRK, at least right now, right? But there are a whole bunch of folks that you work with and you work for and you live with and are your friends and your neighbors that don't realize that cyber is a real threat, vulnerability, and a real fight. It affects all of us 24/7, 365, on and off duty, every device, every touch. Some of you are old enough or have been in service long enough to remember the list of US service members that was gleaned from social media that ended up literally on the hit list of ISIS. I'm getting some vertical nugget nods, right? Let's not make it easy for our adversaries to target us via what they can glean from cyber. If you don't recognize a number on your phone, do you answer it? Do you hit hyperlinks? Is 3M here by chance? M3 here? He's on, okay. So there's plenty of you in the room, so it's okay to raise your hands, I promise. Who hit the hyperlink in the email that was sent out to everyone with my name attached to it about a year ago? Anybody remember that? Yeah. It's real, right? That was an exercise and that was a test, but that stuff happens a lot. And they're gonna be better than that very sloppy exercise, but it was good. So that's a real deal. Make sure your kids know that too. Okay, and then the third combat front is the future fight. So think of our mission statement. Test and evaluation of tomorrow's technology today. That's the future fight. There are kids that big in America right now that'll be the lieutenants and the NCOs of the future that are literally employing the combat power that we are developing for them and maturing for them today. And if we don't keep them in mind with a sense of urgency, but also a sense of excellence, they're gonna be less equipped and less prepared and less likely to make it home. So it's a real deal, and those are our three combat fronts. Three, I'm so pleased that it's three and not four anymore. And let's try to keep it that way. Okay, next slide, please. All right, so with that as a combat analogy, what a D and I do, what a Chief Ward Swanigan and I do, and what is our area of operation, and where do we fight? You know where we don't fight? We don't fight in meetings on the base. We don't bug squadron and group commanders and directors. We don't get in your chilling, we don't micromanage. We take what we learn and what we glean and what we hear from you, and we go fight in the AOR in Sacramento. The AOR in Building 1 on Edwards Air Force Base, the AOR at AFMC headquarters, the AOR that is the five-sided building inside the National Capital Region. That's our area of responsibility. Occasionally we'll pull in Mr. Osborne, occasionally we'll pull in one of the experts like you, Colonel Manning or Colonel Caspers. But this is our primary AOR, and these are the battlefronts that Chief and I are fighting literally every day on all of our behalf, but not on our behalf, but on those that are going to replace us as well. The items that Chief and I have fought, some cases won, other cases not, are listed on the left and right side in no particular order. I suspect all of you don't know what all of those are, but all of you should see one on there and go, yeah, that one would affect me or that one has impacted me, and know that we are fighting there for you and with you. The thing that I need you to know is that I've finally figured out all that we need to do to fix it. It's one simple word, and Chief's going to chime in here without any prep. All we need to do to fix all that stuff is to change policy, right? Chief.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. Yes. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to let Chief talk about two of her favorite or least favorite topics on the sides to give you an example of what we're up against. And I'm not looking for pity. I'm looking actually for your ideas and your engagement. And maybe have you thought about. Does that make sense? So Chief, why don't you pick a couple there? And then sure. I'll hit one or two, and then we got a couple hyperlinks.
So I think one of the popular things, I think everybody can probably relate to most of this, but the hours at the shop at the BX and the commissary, for example, or the hours at any of our stuff that we have here, like at the BX, like that has been a fight for sure. What was it, 8 o'clock when I first got here 18 months ago, drove up to the shop at about 10 o'clock thinking, you know, I didn't get to get any food, so I'll just pop in there. Nope. So we finally got that time increased, and we were looking for more than that, but it's always gonna be based on the need in some instances and the policies. So that's just to give you one.
Yeah, so I'll give a shout out to AFES particularly on that. When AFES leadership, not AFES local, our manager, by the way, local, now Courtney Escobedo, they've been phenomenal partners, mission partners with us and for us. It's a little bit up their management chain that is quite frustrating for us. And when I met that person for the first time and he said, hey, what can I do for Edwards? 24/7, 362, 63, I'll give you 2 days to shut down at the Express, right? How's that sound? Yeah, no joke, right? And he got back, we're not going to make money on those hours that were open overnight, and you will lose dividend. Like, I don't care. What I care about is that when somebody needs something that's in the Express at 2 in the morning, it's open and available. And so he offered to expand hours temporarily as a test case, because we were a test base, and I thought that was mildly funny. And I said, no, if you're going to do it, do it. And if you can't get us to 24/7, then at least expand significantly and hold it. And that has held since we had that expansion. But what's going to push them to do more? A couple things. One, when you get a choice to shop at the Express or someplace else, shop at the Express and shop on the shoulders. Now, don't change your habits to do that. The data don't fake it. But shop on the shoulders. A huge shout out to AFI's gas pricing. Another thing we demanded was meet or beat Costco prices, meet or beat Sam's Club prices. And they have adjusted their local area of gas competition, and we are benefiting from that because they now compete price, because they match local price, right? But not for club stores. I got choice words for that for AFI's, which I won't say online. But the battle that's happening in Boron, Four Corners in Boron right now, is bleeding over into our gas prices. And if you've noticed, at sometimes it's like 20 cents a gallon better on base than it is at the club stores in town. So Gas Buddy's proven out that AFI's can be responsive, but it requires us to patronize them when it makes sense. So take a look, patronize when you can, and that gives us information and more power in that fight. We're going to get there, but it's going to take a little while, and there's a couple things that have to align. Chief, you want to pick another one?
You want to talk housing?
I always want to talk housing. What would you like to talk about housing? And we haven't scripted this clearly, but go ahead.
So if you can see at the top there, 1,989 homes is what we used to have a few years ago, and we're down to 741 homes. As you all know, a lot of times when people PCS in, they would prefer to stay on the base due to the remote and isolated nature, but we don't have enough homes to go around. And so there have been several initiatives. So if you want to click on that, we can actually get into what's behind it.
Yeah, so the number, 1,989, I used to estimate 2,000, and then the CE team said, no, the number's actually 1,989 houses, or residences, some of them were duplexes, that were in the zip code 93523 when I was a student in class 03 alpha, so literally 20 years ago right now. 1,989 houses, and now it's 741 residences. Has our mission shrunk by two-thirds here? What do you think? No way, right? No way. Arguably, we're busier now than we were 20 years ago, and it does rise and flow, but we are certainly no less busy now with less mission demand than we were in 2003. Right, but that number is a dramatic change. The whys are instructive, but I don't think they apply anymore. I've got something later here that on what you can do there, but that is an example of something that we have literally. So my predecessor's predecessor was adamant in let's get more diversity of housing or residential options here, and he launched the Edwards Apartment Complex Initiative, which 6 years later, we're still fighting. So when I say this is our AOR and we're fighting, this is another good example of where we're fighting. 200-ish units is kind of what you see on there in the first bullet. And the May Road, a very good mission partner, community partner here, has capital. They are ready to invest as soon as the Department of Defense says you may start that. Chief and I have clocks that are ticking down. And my threshold for them is we have to be a part of the ceremonial groundbreaking ceremony. And so that tells you how many more months they have to figure it out. And I am burning through the time on airplanes to and from the Pentagon to jump on the desks of the people that are trying to nickel and dime this or slow us down. And we're also getting congressional engagement and congressional questions, which help a lot as well. But I know my predecessor and his predecessor were both optimistic. I'm not optimistic yet. But I see the missile in the air, and it's tracking nicely. It hasn't fused, and I don't see the flame on the bogey, or the hostile wouldn't shoot a bogey. But we're close. And once we can break that, then a lot of these other things fall into place too. There's a lot more in housing and a lot more in the community size there, but there's some other things that we are working on in that. So can you bounce back to the main chart, please? All right. So I can talk through all these. You can ask me questions on what those are. If there's something you want to drill into, we can. The thing that has that finally resonated with Chief and I is that a lot of what we are up against, if we just focus on the things that are on the right and left shoulders, they're whack-a-mole, right? So TLE's whack-a-mole, fill rates, whack-a-mole, HERMA, housing requirements market analysis, whack-a-mole, BAH updates, whack-a-mole. What the consolidated problem there is that higher headquarters policy, and frankly, it's above General Richardson, so AFMC's a big ally and a good ally. Test Center's amazing because a lot of that leadership team lives and works here too. But above AFMC, the policies assume a generic base and a generic wing and a generic population and a generic makeup of the airmen. And we are a special snowflake. We really are. And that's a good thing for the nation. But it means we need some interesting and special considerations. But you know what? We're not alone. There are other installations and other bases and other wings that have similar needs. And it's up to Chief and I to find a coalition there and then rally the forces to change policy. And sometimes the policy is in law. And, you know, we can change the law. A little bit more challenging to change the Constitution, but we can certainly change the law. What's an example of a law change that happened 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, that dramatically or could have dramatically impacted the military? Give me an example. Rhymes with no more mandatory COVID vaccines. Right? That was a law change. Right? What's a law change that just happened this week? Can you go click California licensure compacts, please? So it actually, I found out today after we went final on the charts, but the president literally this week just signed legislation that was co-sponsored by Senator Mike Lee of Utah, and also our very own Congressman Mike Garcia of the district that has Plant 42 in it, and a lot of you live in his district. That requires, as a matter of federal law, those that are licensed in any state in America to have that licensure recognized if you're chasing a spouse that's in the military. How's that sound?
That's a win.
It's huge, right? And that's the AOR we are fighting in. How did that get on Congressman Garcia's radar? Right here. And it's those kind of ideas and those kinds of items. I don't take a lot of credit for what he did because he did the big lift with Senator Lee. They had a couple other co-sponsors in the House. But that's an example of what we can do and what we can move. And policy or law is actually malleable and changeable. We just have to ask the right person at the right time with the right information. So that's a good example. Do you think California is going to take the change of federal law lying down? I don't. So there's another fight to be had, and this one will be had in Sacramento, but at least we'll have the law of the land, not just the law of the state behind us this time. So if you know spouses that are licensed in another state, or you might be a spouse licensed in another state, and you'd like to use those privileges and credentials here in California, you now have federal law on your side as of this week. And so kudos to a Republican House, a Democratic Senate, and a Democratic White House for signing legislation that literally had direct impact to families here at Edwards Air Force Base. All right, next to the, back to the bubble chart, please. All right, the five items across the top you may recognize as Mrs. Brown's Five and Thrive initiatives. We can go through those as well, but her five things are, if you can make these healthy and robust, your community grows, and the installation and the mission grow as well. One of them is medical, another one is childcare. We've already talked about housing, and we've already talked about spouse employment. But schools also matter. Schools, public schools on base remain my number one priority, without caveat. The new school facility, phenomenal. $180 million new campus. What wasn't completely razed and to the ground effectively went to the studs. If you have not been there and seen the Murat Joint Unified Campus, it's really an amazing educational resource. And when you combine that with the spouse licensure portability now, you have an opportunity to provide, we have an opportunity to provide more teachers that are usually or often trailing spouses to the district and that want to live and work on base. And if we have more residences on base, we have more opportunities for more trailing spouses that are teachers to live on base, and it becomes a virtuous cycle. And that's exciting to me. And that's why we fight in that AOR on all of our behalfs. So there are some good glimmers of hope, one that I mentioned already, but it's not listed there. Now, the GAO recognizes that remote and isolated installations need extra consideration, even if they're in CONUS. The Department of the Army is actually ahead of us on this. They wrote a white paper 18 months ago and have policy moving out for Department of the Army installations. And you know what? I'm very happy to copy someone else's good idea. What's that? It's called innovation. Right? Seeing something in another domain, copying it into yours, tweaking it as you want, and moving out. That's innovation. Right? So Department of the Army is moving out. We got that from our partners at Fort Irwin. Who has seen or been through the new FAM camp since it was expanded? I have, right? That was a great partnership between us and AFMC, the AFMC We Need initiative, about a $500,000 expansion, and policy changes that were under my control to allow those military members to be there in a longer term, potentially their entire assignment. We can could potentially expand that more, and I've already talked about apartments. Who are our partners? I've already stated the AFMC staff is exceptionally good partners. AFMC staff, specifically Major General Colley von Hoffman, the AFMC A410, and the SSR thing there, Roach. Chief Roach knows how much we've been fighting for the special salary rate application for a lot of you that are civilian wrench turners in the maintenance group. And she has been a big advocate for that, and I think that one's going to deliver. I can't pick the year yet, but that's an example of the partners that we have and the success we have in that AOR. Air Force Installation and Mission Support Command, also supportive. Major General John Allen is a big advocate of this installation, the solar farm and project. He expected Edwards to lead the state and lead the Department of the Air Force, and we are. February 2nd, we have a big ceremony in the solar farm in the northwest corner of the base. And AFCAC, Air Force Civil Engineering Center, big, big ally and a huge advocate in apartments and a whole bunch of other things for us. SAF Installations and Environment, also an advocate, and they're fighting the fight with me inside the Pentagon. But the top two are ones I want to talk about. I'll talk about the DAF kick there real fast, and then I'll let Chief tell you what Ricky means. We recognized that the Department of the Air Force installations in the state of California were in two services, right? Air Force, Space Force. And I think the total is actually 5 MAGCOMs, depending on how you count Space Force major commands. Right, and the installations are Beale, Travis, Vandenberg, Edwards, Plant 42, March, and LA. And I don't know if it's Space Force Base or Air Force Base. They change their mind every week until they figure out a name for it. But
we'll find out when we get there.
We will find out when we're there next month. But those commanders, those command teams, all individually were getting peppered or asked or you name it via California things. And so we saw an opportunity there for let's build a team and let's name it what it does. So we're a caucus. We are the Department of the Air Force. Can you move that? We are the Department of the Air Force California Installation Commanders Caucus, DAF KIC. And our main AOR as a DAF KIC is people that live and work in Sacramento. And we have a lot of allies in the State Assembly and the State Senate that work with us, but we have a lot of work to do. And mine, I can't wait to charge in with the Lance that is the new law of the land that Congressman Garcia told me about today. So that's what we're doing on your behalf, and we are having success there. If you see something or hear something that we could do different or better that would affect any of those other installations, that's very powerful for us as we move on. Chief, you want to talk about Ricky? It's a little bit more infantile, but it has tremendous opportunity as well. Go ahead.
So remote and isolated CONUS installations, similar to how we're doing the DAF kick, we're kicking off the Ricky in an effort to get with all of the remote and isolated installations, no matter where they sit, but in the CONUS, so that we can do similar things, comparing things, lessons learned, good ideas, going up as a show of force as we go to the Hill and stand on desks to, you know, get policy changed. And so I'm looking forward to that one. We're actually meeting next week to talk to SAFMR about what the GAO 21276 alluded to, and that we need to reassess how we look at remote and isolated bases. So we get to see what those inputs will be that will feed that policy change that SecDef Austin will be rolling out between March and the near future after that. So I look forward to it, sir.
Yeah, so we have the installations of, correct me if I'm wrong here, Beale, Grand Forks, Holloman, and I expect Laughlin to jump into that team, that Ricky Coalition of the Willing. I think a couple more will pile in. And an example that I'm going to present to the Air Force Services Center Commander when she's here end of the month goes to lodging ETP, and ETP is exception to policy. Who thinks the lodging rates for a room on Edwards are just a little too high? Yeah, it's $170 a night, plus or minus. Yeah, think about that. How did they come up with that? Well, the policy is that you have to set your lodging rates at the per diem rate for that area, right? So if you're here at TDY, it's a one-for-one exchange rate, and that's money to the Air Force lodging or Air Force Inns, right? I don't have a beef with that. Do I like that? Kind of doesn't matter, but I don't have a beef with that. What I have a beef with is that in an area where we are generally low on housing inventory, where one-third of the on-base residences that we had 20 years ago, and a lot of us got crushed by the compounding housing crisis during the pandemic, we are spending collectively more time in lodging, both the TLFs and actual visiting quarters, than we would normally. And when you're out of pocket, to be out of pocket above what your BAH is by a lot, that doesn't set right with me, nor should it set right with anybody else. And so a lot of those other CONUS installations are similarly situated. Air Force Services Center has an opportunity to change policy to allow someone at a local base to say, hey, how about 5% above 1/30th of your BAH when you're waiting for a house on base? Or when you're waiting for your house to close, or you're waiting for your house to get built, or because you genuinely are looking for a place to live and can't find one yet. And that's something that was initially denied, and I said, no, we're going to fight it again, and that's, Ricky's going to help us there. Colonel Ammons is going to hear that from me again. And kudos to MSG, specifically Lieutenant Colonel Thixon right there, who helped us write it on that ATP. I think there's a lot of benefit and a lot of opportunity there. And that's an example of, if I can do it or we can do it for Edwards as a remote and isolated CONUS installation, it should automatically apply to all the other bases that are similarly situated and have the same label. And anything they earn or they fight should retroactively or simultaneously apply here as well. Does that make sense? So, hey, that's kind of new and different. No, it isn't. We do that for overseas U.S. bases all the time. Raise your hands if you've served at Eielson. Keep them up. Elmendorf, keep them up. How about Guam, right? You all know what overseas U.S. installations get and what's different here. And that's a great analogy that we're fighting with, that we're going to take to the fight with the Ricky team. So, with that is where we fight, our three combat fronts, where we are, a reminder of our vision and our mission. It's time, folks. Next chart. What can you do? Okay? So, you need to speak up. Please don't suffer in silence. I'll give you an actual vignette. I had a visiting commander, happened to be a one-star. I had dinner with that one-star and his spouse, and the spouse had been delivered by the local command team, spouse of the local command team, effectively a long list of grievances that she presented to me over dinner, because I'd known him for 25 or 30 years, right? And I'm like, wow, if I had known about these, we could have addressed some of them. More than half of them we did know about and we were already addressing, but the others I was unaware of. So please don't suffer in silence. And also don't make the assumption that the top five team and the 412 test wing knows, right? How do you get it to us direct? It's right there, 707-412-8922. Another way you can get it to us direct,
it's on the next slide.
Okay, it'll be on the next slide. It's the Edwards app, right? That's another way you can do this direct. You can also funnel it up your chain of command, and there's a whole bunch of ways you can do that. You can talk to your shirt. You can talk to your commander. You can talk to any chief. You can talk to any colonel. You can talk to any one-star you happen to see on the base, too. Okay? All right. We need to hear from you, and I need you to speak up, and I absolutely don't want you to suffer in silence. I give you a great example that we've already talked about already. there in the past have been junior enlisted folks here that are paying 170 bucks a night out of pocket waiting on their residence, and they didn't speak up in a loud enough manner until they got 4, 5, 6, $7,000 in debt. Right? 170 times 30, do the math real fast. Look up 07 BAH. I can't even afford 30 days of housing and lodging here, so nobody else can either. And that finally popped off to a congressional delegation, and then there's the time to go up the congressional route and back down the congressional route before we found out. We did everything we could for that family and other families similarly situated, and that was one of the emphasis items that got us TLE extensions, right? But they weren't permanent, and that's another thing we're fighting now. So speak up, okay? We have a town hall that is hosted by myself and or chief or another senior leader from the wing every duty Friday, 1500. It's not always in person like this. Sometimes it's just virtual, but show up, listen, or watch it after the fact, and it's there. We need to hear from you. We push information to you. That's where we'll have award ceremonies. That's where we'll have other big events, like we did a helping agencies ribbon cutting, helping agencies building ribbon cutting ceremony at the last town hall. So those are the kind of things that we'll have there. Get there, text in your questions, comments. And then another thing that you can do, and these are examples, but you can join the Parent Teacher Association, which is a registered private org on the base. You can join another parent teacher organization. You can communicate with the school as a parent and a coalition of parents, and we want to help you do that. Unfortunately, Chief and I don't have any children enrolled in schools on the base that are in our house that we're the sponsors for, but we care about all of yours. And so if you want to be in the PTA or PTO or other parent organization, let us know, and let us know how we can help advocate with you and for you, especially as you organize. So that's one thing you can do. You can run for the school board, by the way, and that's not a hollow thing as well. The school board desperately needs people to join for MIROC. You can become a key spouse. You can become a key spouse supporter or cheerleader. You can join private orgs and then direct your private org to things that would help the installation. A great example of a private org that helps the installation all the time is run by Scout Master Mizell right here, right? Yeah, go scouting, right? And the Eagle Scout projects are tremendously helpful for the installation, and they're good for the Eagle Scouts too. So those are examples of synergistic things that you can do. And the last one is, and I'm not telling you to go write your senator or your congressman. However, when you have an opportunity to communicate with members of the local community, to include local elected officials, city, county, school board, state assembly, state senate, state elected officials at the state level, so the governor, lieutenant governor, secretary of education, those kinds of places, communicate openly and freely with your observations. And if they say, hey, you're in the military, you can say, yes, I'm giving you my best military advice. And give it to them, right? And that would also include members of Congress, to include congressmen, members of the House and the Senate. Continue to communicate. If you lodge a complaint with a member of Congress, it's going to end up in a congressional. It'll go up the chain and back down the chain, and I will answer it, and it'll go back to them, and it'll go back to you, which is fine. You can do that. But you can also provide them your feedback, as I did in a phone call with a congressman earlier today. All right? That's what you can do. All right, next. This is another way for you to get in touch with us, and I encourage you to use the app. That's what it looks like. There's a QR code you can hit with your phones now if you want. It's the official social media presence for Edwards Air Force Base. We rely on the public affairs team to monitor all of those other social media sites with the Edwards presence, but that's not where we engage for a bunch of reasons, and I'll talk to a few of them here. But I really don't like to drop F-bombs, but my least favorite F-word has 8 letters. Why? Why is that my least favorite one? Remember we talked about fighting in cyber? How have they done? We were streaming an event from this stage over Facebook Live and other channels, and Facebook censored us. See there, I'm swearing. I'm using the 8-letter F word, right? That's why, an example among many others, why we don't use official presence on any of the commercial social media sites, and instead we have our own. It's the Edwards app, and it's Takata 2 Live from your awesome public affairs professionals. Go there, direct your folks there. If you have a site that is on one of those other media things, point or give a pointer to the official Edwards site. This app is not just available on your device, it's also, you can put it on your desktop, and you can also get to it through any browser as well. There are presence, and the more of us that are there, the more valuable it is and the more beneficial it is. And there's a feedback mechanism on it for the app itself and also to get to us. Chief takes messages there all the time.
Okay? Got some pretty cool ideas here recently in my Dropbox. So yes, please continue to push those. Thank you.
Yeah, and I'm not kidding when I say I discourage you to use commercial social media venues because of their security, their lack of concern for your privacy, the risks to you, your family, and candidly, as a member of the military, to risk to our national defense. And I also don't appreciate the censorship that they do for a lot of the materials that we need to talk about, which they have decided are not appropriate. So the subject matter that we were talking about on stage that day when that eight-letter F word cut us off, it was suicide, right? We need to talk about stuff like that, and I don't want somebody else to tell us what we can and cannot talk about. So I hope that makes sense. All right, so there it is, next. And now we get to read your questions. There's somebody over here that has a big, long list of them already, and I'll take them in person as well. The really tough questions Chief's going to get. If we don't know the answer, we're not going to BS you. If the answer is knowable, we'll get back to you, even if we don't have it right now. If I can't answer it, I won't. But this is a chance for you to dialogue with us in person and for you to get in questions if you have some that have been texted in. So I give time for the audience to get some bravery up.
We've got four here too as well, sir.
Yeah, and there's a long list of cards there. Anybody in person? Right there. I'll repeat the, okay, there we go.
Hey, sir, Sergeant Habracker from the 412th Maintenance Squadron. I just have one question for you. It's back on your command team area of operations slide.
Can you go back to that chart, please? Go ahead.
Yes, sir. So really what it is the information that you have there is excellent. It looks like there's a lot of really good hyperlinks to see statuses of different things that affect our airmen throughout the installation. I took a quick look during this slide. I don't see it on the Edwards app or anything like that. Is it possible to put this information on there so I can, when I have an airman going through one of these situations, I might be able to click on a link and see what the current status is at the wing, where we're at, and what's going on?
Is it possible? Yes. Can we hang something somewhere that you can get to it? Yes. I don't intend this to be a portal. Mm-hmm. But if there are specific topics that you want that are here, the portal is the edwards.af.mil website and or the app. But there are a lot of topics in here that we will try to keep updated and posted. And if that would be of value to some of you, then we're happy to do it. So it'll go on the splash page initially. We'll track how many hits it gets. And if it's not valid or if it's not current, we'll pull it off. I'll have to strip some of these. Mm-hmm. Because I can't hang them on the public domain, but I'm happy to talk about them. So he won't hang it, but he'll talk about it streaming. Huh. But anyway, that's a good response. Is there one specific here that piqued your interest?
Well, there's several. I know people talk about the apartment buildings, and people want information on that. They want to know about medical is a very hot topic people talk about. People talk about TLE and lodging. I mean, there's probably nearly every unit. Everything that you have on there is something that I talk with my airmen virtually every day. I've got someone I'm talking with about it, and it'd be good to be able to hit that link, see, hey, here's where the test wing is looking at, here's the status, here's what's going on, instead of having to try and chase that down separately, kind of a one-stop shop to say this is what the test wing is doing.
I'm totally good with hanging something somewhere that helps people communicate better. We've been hanging COVID status slides or the weather brief there for a long time. I personally have used that multiple times. Give us a couple weeks to figure out what to hang there, and then if there's something that we can update and use in a portal fashion, we'll do that.
Copy that.
Thanks for
the
input. Now, the first one you mentioned was housing, right? So, medical. The first one you mentioned was medical. Can you click the Medical Desert hyperlink for me, please? The Medical Desert phrase was actually presented to me or coined by the commander at the previous commander, actually at Vandenberg, and he described the central belt in California as a medical desert. There's a lot just to our south you know, once you get into the larger LA basin, but you have to go there to get a lot of it. It typically revolves around specialty care. When you look in the central swath here, you got Vandenberg, Space Force, Channel Lake, what service? Navy, Edwards Air Force, right? What about Yuma, Marine Corps, and what have I left out? Fort Irwin, Army. So we have five installations in five different services, and there was no way we were gonna align medical resources in the Department of the Navy, Department of the Air Force, and the Department of the Army, because they had their own medical stovepipes. And then what happened? There was a hostile takeover in the medical world, and it's all now belongs to Defense Health Agency. All right, so let's take advantage of that opportunity in good Winston Churchill fashion, right? And now let's demand to the Defense Health Agency Chief of Staff, who happens to be a one-star former 412th Med Group commander, and say, hey, here's an opportunity for you to pool resources and the circuit rider. So the medical desert was coined by the commander at Vandy. The circuit rider concept was coined by the CG at Fort Irwin. And the concept is a specialty team that would provide routine specialty care, holds clinic on a predictable scheduled basis at those MTFs. So for example, every Wednesday dermatology at Edwards, every Thursday dermatology at Fort Irwin. See where I'm going? Now where they assigned kind of doesn't matter, what service really doesn't matter. The med techs locally would be able to help out a dermatologist, and that circuit rider would be the provider. And that is of interest to DHA, and we have to give them enough information to make it happen and make it operationalized. And dermatology is actually one of them that they're looking at, and there are two or three others that are high on the list. It would not be for procedural items or major procedural items, but there are a lot of specialty care things that are routine in nature. And so that's a big benefit. And that coalition happens to be the Mojave Commander Summit combined with the DAF KIC. So it's command relationships, but relationships amongst commanders and chiefs trump command relationships all the time. And that's a good example of that. And I can go on and on. Another one that we can talk about, go back to the base chart. It's on the chart as well. Urgent care clinics. How far do you have to drive if you live at 93523 to get to an urgent care center? Past Rosemont. Right, it's not even there anymore. When the med group reconsolidates out of their buildings into their new facilities, which are opening up here one at a time, there's going to be enough room left for what the med group thinks is an urgent care clinic, and now we have to find a partner and a provider that's interested in being here. I have a commercial partner that is interested in using us as a test case for an urgent care clinic on the installation, actually in the med group, and I think there's great opportunity there. But if they're here, what do you have to do? Just like the Express, you got to use it, which I don't think will be a problem. But that's another great example there. Thanks for bringing it up, and I appreciate that. Okay, Chief, you want to hit one that got zapped in from the cyber domain?
Let's see here. We got some good ones. You already hit one of those. Okay. With the change in the vaccine mandate, will our unvaccinated airmen and civilians be able to go TDY now?
So there's two policies that are colliding there. And the first policy is now law that the Department of Defense can no longer mandate vaccinations for military members. So that's law. What's the other policy colliding with that? An executive order mandating that before we spend money for folks to travel, you have to be vaccinated. And so until the executive branch and the congressional branch align or figure it out, there's going to be a conflict or a misalignment. And so what right now is in place, if you are unvaccinated or you're a civilian and you've chosen not to declare your COVID vaccination status, your travel has to be declared mission critical. And the lowest level of approval, the lowest approval level for that declaration is unfortunately the Undersecretary of the Air Force, the Honorable Jones Ortiz right now. So until that executive policy is rescinded, the vaccination mandate is almost irrelevant for mission critical and mission critical travel purposes. And so that's the status on that one. Every single forum that I've been in for the last going on year now, that question gets asked, not just when I'm on stage, but when I'm in the audience. the four stars that answer that question kind of do the same thing I just went to you above my pay grade. Okay, so what Mr. Osborne's telling me is that while we've been up here on stage, an email dropped, maybe a little bit before that, that we are expecting policy changes on that soon, and I'm not going to give the number of days because I've been burned by that before. But it's illogical right now, and logic will prevail. Just be patient on it to get the time there. If you are or you work with folks that are unvaccinated that have actual mission-critical travel, continue to process and submit those requests. It takes about a 45-day minimum lead time for us to get them to the under and back. And her approval rates we have a pretty good prediction on what the approval rate is, depending on what type of travel it is, and the expert there is in our CAG shop. Okay, so I got time for one more, and then I'll release you only a couple minutes late, because we started a couple minutes late. And I'll give the in-person audience first bite at that last question.
I think it's right here.
Where is it? It's right there? All right. So I don't believe you, so keep texting in your questions, please, or hit me up when you see me in the Express at 2300 because I'm doing the last minute, okay? All right, Chief, go ahead.
You spoke about SSR for maintenance group. Is there a chance to implement Title 38 SSR for local nurses?
Whew. So SSR, the special salary rates, it applies to federal civil servants, and you can just look up the special salary rates based on career field, if you will, and locality. There is an SSR that's been on the books for maintainers in this locality, but we were not allowed to implement it. So it's the implementation of something that's been on the books for 3 years? Does that sound about right, Roach? Yeah, 3/4 years. So as I told you when I answer questions, if I don't know the answer, I'll tell you, I don't know the answer, but we'll look it up. So if there's a special salary rate available in the local area for nurses,
correct.
Text that in, please, whoever asked that question. And that will allow us to package it better, and we can float that through the appropriate channels. The way that they get approved is interesting because it's an enduring commitment of resources in the form of salary, but it's already approved. And so that's another discrepancy or misalignment that I have to have advocacy from you or data from you that allows me to provide advocacy up and find an interesting ear. Other career fields, civilian career fields, where this would be beneficial, and we are also aware in fighting comm experts, right? Air crew, air traffic controllers, engineers, right? So there's a lot of career specialties where we are fighting the fight to be able to be a little bit more competitive in salary with the civilian world, recognizing that there are significant advantages of being a part of this team, even if your W-2 at the end of the year means you pay a little less in tax. Okay? So that's a good last question. We got the rest, so if you asked one or want to ask one, type it in real fast. We'll either address this back to you if you leave a contact information, if it's a specific question for you, or we'll address it at a future town hall, which are every duty Friday at 1500. Broadcast on this, and they're recorded, so if you miss it, you can replay it. The ones that I don't attend, I generally watch, because I'm interested to see the dialogue. We think this is a better time slot, so you can critique the time slot in the day of the week, too, if you want. We'll take that feedback also. And it's awesome to have this experience today. Chief, I'm elated to see the crowd here today, and I'll give you some parting thoughts before as I put mine together, and then we'll clear off for the day. Go ahead.
So you kind of talked about it earlier. So calendar quarter one for 2023, I get excited and fired up about the new year every year, and so I'm looking forward to all the new initiatives that are going to come about as we kick off this new year. We have some really great airmen in all uniforms here on Edwards, and they're kicking butt all the time. And you know, we'll be doing our annual awards ceremony here soon to recognize some of those individuals. But just things like that, where we get a chance to come out and recognize folks, congratulate folks, just put eyes on folks and just mingle and listen to what you all have for us so that we can continue to go fight. Please continue to do that. Please provide those inputs. Use that Dropbox on the Chief's Corner that's on the app, and all those other channels that the boss kind of talked about. And happy new year. If if I haven't said that enough, and yeah, let's just keep being great. We appreciate it, and let's get after that. Refocus on excellence.
Right, team. This is thrilling to me to be in a room with a few hundred of you. It's actually great to be in person, and I'm sure you observed that as well. It's also great to see what we are accomplishing, not just what we did, but what we are accomplishing going forward. That doesn't happen without all of us and without all of you. I actually don't think of a command job as being on the top of an organizational pyramid. I think of the command job that all the command jobs that I've had and all the commanders that I've worked for have exemplified not being on the top of the organizational pyramid, but being actually at the base of support, because it's this crowd that actually does the job, right? Mm-hmm. So let us know what we can do different or better as we support from this position and from this command team to support you. On duty, off duty, on base, off base, cyber domain or other domain, let us know and don't be shy. And there was a point, right? What can you do? Speak up, right? We absolutely need to hear you. So if you get nothing else out of this, remember the number 707-412-8922 and or find the Edwards app, communicate with us there, and then pull us aside as you see us in person, right? And maybe I can watch you smile because it's a no-mask season, right? Okay. Everybody watching online, thank you. All the watch parties you're having, great. Nice, innovative idea. For all of you that are in here in person, thank you for being here and making this a special event. Like, not just the first one of the new year that has been a town hall, but first one in person in 3 years. And that, I can't tell you how great that is. And the very last thing I'm going to say is thank you. Thank you for everything you do, not just for everything you've done, but thank you for everything you do as a member of a very small force protecting the rest of this nation and her allies into the future. Our primary adversary has 1.4 billion people, and we have less than 0.4 billion. How am I confident we are still going to stay out in front of that adversary? Because our less than 0.4 billion are you, and you're unconstrained, and you innovate, and you think, and you talk, and you coordinate, and you collaborate, and you know what? You cuss and discuss a little bit too, and that's a good thing, right? So continue to do that, and thank you for doing all that, and thank you for refocusing on everything you do, but especially on excellence the next couple months, and then make it a solid habit as you go forward the rest of your career. And with that, I wish you a great Friday. Everybody have a safe weekend.
Room, teach, hut.
Carry on, please.